From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Otolaryngology Head and Neck Surgery Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinions featured in JAMA Otolaryngology Head and Neck Surgery.
Hello, welcome to our podcast series here at JAMA Oto. I'm Paul Bryson, media editor for JAMA Oto, and I'm delighted to speak with Dr. Joseph Scharpf from the Cleveland Clinic today about his recent publication on the evolution of treatment strategies and outcomes for anaplastic thyroid carcinoma. Dr. Scharpf is the director of the Complex Endocrine Oncologic Surgery Service here, as well as vice chairman of professional development within the Head and Neck Institute. Welcome to the podcast, Dr. Scharpf.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here, Dr. Bryson.
Well, I wanted to congratulate you on your recent article. It's titled Association of Treatment Strategies and Tumor Characteristics with Overall Survival Among Patients with Anaplastic Thyroid Carcinoma. Could you share with our listeners just a little bit about, maybe some of the background of anaplastic thyroid carcinoma and what led you to take a look back at your and our institution's experience with this?
Sure. The thyroid is a pretty fascinating organ in that you have some disease processes like micropapillary or small papillary thyroid cancers that are treated with active surveillance that could be indolent, and then all the way up to maybe one of the worst cancers known to humankind in anaplastic thyroid cancer. And most of the mortality that we see from thyroid cancer often will come from those patients suffering from anaplastic cancer. And the expected lifespan has been traditionally very, very poor for those diagnosed with anaplastic thyroid cancer, usually measured within weeks or 3 to 4 months of survival, often with very difficult course of compromise of basic functions, of breathing, swallowing. And so one of the things that we wanted to do is look and see how some of the treatment has evolved for this disease process that's so critical to helping our patients. A big impetus for the study were dramatic changes that have come about in the treatment of anaplastic thyroid cancer over the past 3 to 4 years with the introduction of targeted therapies, particularly for those patients that have BRAF mutations in their anaplastic thyroid cancer, which happens about half of the time, about 45 to 50% of the time. These patients we've seen through smaller studies, particularly the ROAR study, which was a phase 2 basket trial study with dabrafenib and trametinib, started to show survival at 1 and 2 year rates that were out of the realm of where they had been traditionally. And so these patients are responding to these targeted therapies. We wanted to look back at our own experience here at the Cleveland Clinic with a large cohort of patients, about 97 patients, to see where our historical outcomes have been, to give us a basis or background for looking at improvements that we're making with future targeted therapies and strategies for our patients. The improvements that were seen in this small study of the ROAR of only 16 patients were so significant that it actually became part of the ATA, American Thyroid Association, guidelines for anaplastic thyroid cancer that came out in 2021.
Yeah, I was going to say, I've been in practice now for a little more than 12 years, but I think certainly as we look back at each other's training experience and historically taking care of these patients, it was a pretty grim diagnosis. So it's pretty exciting to hear that outcomes have improved and that there are some different treatment options for them. Can you share a little bit about how you approached the review, sort of what characteristics you were able to find and how you approached the data design and acquisition?
Sure. So one of the advantages, although this is a retrospective study, we fortunately have very complete notes for our patients here at the Cleveland Clinic. And so it allows us to get a granularity that you may not find in other studies from anaplastic thyroid cancer that might use large national databases. And so with that in mind, we were able to look at treatment characteristics of patients, whether they receive radiation, chemotherapy, targeted therapy, surgery. We were able to look at unique tumor characteristics of patients, such as their BRAF status, other mutational aberrations that they might have had. We have records that look at all the targeted therapies patients have had throughout this period of time and their toxicities to the treatment. And so with those kind of characteristics, we're able to have a little bit more of a closer look at the patients and how they were treated. And then, of course, we have the clinical outcomes. We've had, fortunately, a lot of patients who follow up quite closely, and we're able to see how they've done from a clinical outcome standpoint in terms of overall survival and some of the functional toxicity issues from the treatment that I mentioned.
Yeah. So as you were able to get through the data, what did the team find? What was, some of the take-home points, and what was most surprising to you?
So some of our results did corroborate what's been seen in other studies in terms of treatment. And then we found some unique findings. When we looked at our characteristics for the patient, so all anaplastic thyroid cancer is automatically stage 4. Most of our patients were stage 4C, which would be distant metastatic disease. We saw that in 55% of our patients. About 20% each had 4A and 4B, which would be 4A just isolated to the thyroid, 4B regional metastatic disease. We saw that patients tended to do better when they had a lower tumor stage, younger age, ability to receive definitive or adjuvant radiation therapy. We broke up the cohort, which went from 2000 to 2021. We broke it up at 2014 because at 2014, we started using targeted therapies on some of our patients as well. And so for those patients, we had about 29% of our patients receive targeted therapies. And although the numbers are a bit small, it's certainly showing a trend of some improvement for those particular patients that could have targeted therapies compared to traditional means of radiation or surgery or traditional chemotherapy.
That's pretty exciting. You know, as you look back to, you know, patient presentation and sort of the diagnosis and treatment paradigm, what has changed most for you over the course of your career with this malignancy? And then in light of these findings, how has the approach changed with the group?
There's several things that have changed. When I went through training, everything was very, very focused on palliation to the point where many patients often had a tracheotomy at beginning of diagnosis. Many of the patients often were a bit delayed sometimes in the diagnosis and how rapid this is, but even a delay of a few weeks is a big issue for this kind of disease process. And so a few things have changed. We don't automatically put tracheotomies in patients. We try to actually hold off on that if they have a stable airway. The rapidity of getting the diagnosis and getting them under treatment is emphasized because it's critical to get tissue immediately on these patients, and not just with necessarily an FNA biopsy, but a core biopsy or a surgical specimen so that we could do that molecular testing to see if they would be able to get these targeted treatments. And that's a big change from where things have been in the past in terms of just rapidly getting the multidisciplinary team approach together with our radiation and medical oncologists, our endocrine service, and then our own surgical services. So the emphasis on getting the patients in, even for same-day appointments, we'll offer them. If we hear that a patient may have this diagnosis, anyone on our team looks to get these patients in immediately as a team effort on the same day or within a couple of days of hearing about this.
Yeah, that's great. It sounds like everybody rallies up when these come in. I know they're still relatively uncommon, but I think at a large center, these patients certainly come in. So it's good to hear that the process sounds to be kind of streamlined and people try to get in and get diagnosed and get the workup going so you can start treatment. And I think you guys have a tumor board process that you'll take patients through.
Yes, we do. We have two tumor boards. We have a head and neck cancer tumor board, which is actually very relevant for our anaplastic thyroid cancer patients because that includes our medical and radiation oncologists there. We also have a separate thyroid cancer tumor board, and that's valuable as well.
Yeah, that's great. Well, you know, as you look to the future, what do you think is next or what is ongoing with anaplastic thyroid carcinoma? What are you excited about and what are you and the group doing both at the Cleveland Clinic, but also what do you see nationally?
I think for anaplastic and actually all thyroid cancer, there's going to be such an increased emphasis on the molecular profiling of these tumors to see what particular targets could be valuable, particularly for anaplastic cancer. We've engaged in a clinical trial that had been spearheaded actually by our colleagues at MD Anderson, and we're a center that has opened for this trial that will use dabrafenib and trametinib, also with immunotherapy using pembrolizumab. So that'll be exciting to see how that's going to take place. It's not going to be a single agent or treatment that is probably going to see success in all these patients. It's going to be a multi-agent approach. And for some patients that would have had unresectable cancers on presentation because it was encasing the carotid artery or is so extensively involving the laryngotracheal complex. We're hoping to get results where there can be a change and a response to treatment to create a surgical opportunity to remove these tumors. And as this is being done, people are finding that most of the anaplastic component has been alleviated, and they may just see papillary thyroid cancer components still present. And that's certainly something that's very exciting to see in the future. Within our own group at the Cleveland Clinic, we're also looking at other options and strategies. We have a wonderful basic science team with Dr. Jeff Knopf, who's world-renowned in basic science with anaplastic thyroid cancer. One of my partners, Dr. Natalie Silver, also will be working in basic science with him and working perhaps on vaccination trials for these tumors. And so I think there are many different avenues of exploration that are going to be opening up here in the near future.
Well, you know, it seems like a lot has changed in not too long of a time. So it seems like there's a lot of reasons to be, you know, optimistic about the sorts of discovery and treatment refinement.
Yeah, it absolutely is. And this is a disease process that, you know, it's just so difficult to treat, but it's so uplifting now to be able to have hope for these patients in a more realistic way than we had in the past, and knowing that some of these patients are responding so well to some of the new targeted therapies, I think it's going to be very, very positive going forward to continue to help them.
Well, it's great to hear. I congratulate you and the team on this publication, and really appreciate your time today.
Thank you. We really appreciate and we're honored to be on the podcast with you. Thank you.
This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. The audio team also includes Mary Lynn Furkeluk, Audrey Foreman, Lisa Harden, Hannah Park, Shelley Steffens, and Dr. Linda Brubaker, Senior Editor, Multimedia. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next time.